Good morning, children. Today we are going to see a new lesson, Great Thinkers and New Faiths. Children, in this lesson we are going to study about Jainism and Buddhism. This 6th century BC is mentioned as a landmark period in ancient history. This BC 6th century is a very very important period in ancient history. During this period only intellectual and spiritual development takes place in India. The historian Will Durant called this period as showers of stars. And Jain text Angas and Buddhist text Jatakas and Tripitakas were written during this period. Children, now we are going to see about the causes for the rise of intellectual awakening and birth of Buddhism and Jainism. When we see about the causes, there were several reasons for the rise of new intellectual awakening. Let us see what are they. First, during the later Vedic period, they followed some complex rituals and sacrifices. To do that sacrificial ceremonies, they have to spend more money. So they were very expensive. And that superstitious beliefs, when you say that they believe in what is not right, that is they followed a foolish or ridiculous, and that belief and practices that confused the people. And when you say the Upanishad, and this Upanishad was given as alternative to the Vedas, and this Upanishad was very philosophical, and that words cannot be understand by the lay person. Slavery system, caste system and gender discrimination are the main reasons that contributed to the new awakening. Now let us see the origin of Jainism. Origin of Jainism. When you say Jainism, who is the founder of Jainism, children? Yes, Mahavira. Jainism is the one of the oldest living religion. Today also people follow this religion. So we can say that one of the living religion in the world. One of the living religion. Jainism grounds itself in 24 Tirthankaras. A Tirthankara is a person, one who preaches the religious truth at different times. What they will do? They will preach the religious truth. The name of the first Tirthankara was Rishabha. First Tirthankara Rishabha, and the last one, that is the 24th Tirthankara, was Mahavira. Mahavira, as we said already, Mahavira is the founder of Jainism. Jainism gained importance during the period of Mahavira, that is during the 6th BC. 6th century BC. Mahavira, the great hero, the word Jain is derived from the Sanskrit word Jinna. From where it is derived? From a Sanskrit word Jinna, that means conquering self and the external world. To overcome self and the external world. Now we see about the Vartamana. Vardhamana Mahavira is the full name of Mahavira. Vardhamana meaning prosperous. Prosperous means rich and successful. And he was the Kshatriya prince. He left that place at the age of 30. That means he left the princely status at 30 years and he went to the forest to do the meditation. That means he adopted an ascetic life. He undertook intense meditation. And after 12 and a half years of rigorous penance, rigorous meditation, Vardhamana attained a supreme knowledge known as Kevala. K-E-V-A-L-A, Kevala. And thereafter, he became Jinna. Jinna means one who conquered worldly pleasure and attachment. Jinna means one who conquered worldly pleasure and attachment. Those who follow Mahavira are called Jains. Mahavira reviewed the ancient ceremonial traditions and came up with new doctrines. And therefore, he was believed to be the real founder of Jainism. Unique teachings of Jainism. Jainism denies, that means they refuse, they are not accepting God as the creator of universe. They are not accepting God as the creator of universe. Basic philosophy of Jainism is Ahimsa, that means not to kill, or non-violence. The ultimate aim of Jainism is attaining moksha. Only to attain moksha is the main aim of the Jainism, or ending the cycle of birth, death and rebirth. Jains reject the belief in last judgment. We are saying that no, God will come at the end and he will decide who goes to heaven and hell. The Jain people, they are not believe in last judgment, where God is a supreme being and judgment will be given to the people, and they are not accepting it. Jainism advocates that the goodness or quality of one's life is determined by one's karma. Our life is determined by one's karma. What is karma? The belief that a person's action in this life determines the quality of his or her later part of the current life and the next incarnation. Karma means what? The belief that a person's action, அதாவது ஒருத்தவங்க செய்கிற நல்ல செயல்களே இந்த பிறவியோட பிற்பகுதி வாழ்க்கையும் அடுத்த பிறவியில் வாழப்போகும் வாழ்க்கையும் தீர்மானிக்குது அப்படின்ற நம்பிக்கை. தட் இஸ் கால்டு கர்மா. மகாவீரா எக்ஸாட்டட் த threefold path. Exhorted means strongly. He strongly encouraged the people to follow the threefold path to attain moksha and for the liberation from karma. What are they?
right faith, right knowledge, and right action. We said to attain moksha, we have to follow the threefold path said by Mahavira. What is moksha? Moksha is nothing but liberation from the cycle of birth and death. That is called moksha.
Jain Code of Conduct. Mahavira asked his followers to live or to behave in a morally good way. That is called a virtuous life. In order to live a life filled with sound morals, he preached five major principles to follow. They are Ahimsa, Satya, Asteya, Aparigraha, and Brahmacharya. First, Ahimsa means not to injure any living being. Should not give any trouble to the living things. Satya means to speak truth. Always we should speak the truth. Asteya means not to steal. And then aparigraha is nothing but not to own property. We are not supposed to have affection towards the properties. Brahmacharya is celibacy. Celibacy means unmarried life. Now, Gautama Swami is a chief disciple of Mahavira. Gautama Swami. Chief disciple of Mahavira compiled the teachings of Mahavira. The name of the book is Agama Siddhanta. What is the name of the book? Agama Siddhanta. Now Jainism split into two sects. They are the Digambaras and Svetambaras. Digambaras are orthodox and conservative followers. They will strictly follow the religions and they will not accept any changes. Digambaras do not wear any clothing and they live a naked life. And they are denied to possess any kind of possessions. That means they are not supposed to keep any property for themselves. Women cannot achieve nirvana or liberation directly. Svetambaras, they are considered progressive. Progressive means they can follow or they can have forwarding ideas. They will follow new religion. Whatever is advanced, they will follow that. And these monks of Svetambara's sect wear white clothes and they are permitted to have Rajohana. Rajohana is a broom that is made up of woolen threads. Rajohana is a broom made of woolen threads. Begging bowl and a book. They are permitted to have all these three. And Svetambaras believe that women are equally capable of achieving liberation as men. Women also can achieve liberation like men. reason for the spread of Jainism. Now we can say the following main reasons for the spread of Jainism. First, the monks in the Jainism use people's language. Second one, intelligible teachings, and their teachings are easily, they can understand their teaching easily, and support from the rulers and traders. Fourth one, perseverance of Jain monk. Perseverance means we can say vidam muyachi of the Jain monks. These are the reasons because of that only Jainism spread in India.
Influence of Jainism in Tamil Nadu. In ancient Tamil literature, this Jainism is mentioned as Samanam. And there is a Samanar Hill in Keelakuyilkudi village, that is a village 15 kilometers from Madurai. In that place, we can see the images of Tirthankaras created by Jain monks. And it is protected monument of Archaeological Survey of India. இந்திய தொல்பொருள் ஆய்வுத்துறை வந்து இன்றைக்கும் அதை நினைவு சின்னமாக பாதுகாத்துட்டு வராங்க. இன் அரிட்டாப்பட்டி, திஸ் ஆல்சோ எ வில்லேஜ் ப்ரெசன்ட் இன் மதுரை, தட் இஸ் 25 kilometers அவே ஃப்ரம் மதுரை. அண்ட் ஒன் சைட் ஆஃப் கலிஞ்சமலை, தட் இஸ் அ ஹில், தேர் யூ கேன் சி ஜெயின் கேவ்ஸ் called Pandavar Padukai. This Pandavar Padukai is nothing but it is the bed of the Jain saints. And fourth one, there is a reference to Aravor Palli, place of living for Jain monks in Manimegalai. And the Samanathuravigal vaazhndha idam அப்படின்றத மணிமேகலைன்ற நூலில் ரெஃபர் பண்ணியிருக்காங்க. அக்கார்டிங் டு சிலப்பதிகாரம், வென் கோவலன் அண்ட் கண்ணகி வேர் ஆன் தேர் வே டு மதுரை, கவுந்தி அடிகள் எ ஃபீமேல் ஜெயின் மங்க் பிளஸ் த கப்பிள் அண்டு அக்கம்பனேடு தெம். ஃபிஃப்த் ஒன், புகார், உறையூர், மதுரை, வாஞ்சி அண்ட் காஞ்சி ஆல் ஹேட் ஜெயின் மோனஸ்ட்ரிஸ். மோனஸ்ட்ரிஸ்னா மடாலயம் அப்படின்னு சொல்கிறோம். ஜைன காஞ்சி இன் காஞ்சிபுரம், தெர் இஸ் அ வில்லேஜ் நேம் திருப்பருத்தி குன்றம். இட் ஹாஸ் டூ ஏன்ஷியன் டெம்பிள்ஸ் அண்ட் திஸ் வில்லேஜ் வாஸ் ஒன்ஸ் கால்டு ஜைன காஞ்சி.
புத்திசம். நவ் வி ஆர் கோயிங் டு சி அபவுட் கௌதம புத்தா. சில்ட்ரன், கேன் யூ டெல் மீ ஹூ வாஸ் த ஃபவுண்டர் ஆஃப் புத்திசம்? எஸ், புத்தா, கௌதம புத்தா வாஸ் த founder of Buddhism. The real name of Buddha was Siddhartha, S-I-D-D-H-A-R-T-H-A, Siddhartha. His place of birth was Lumbini Garden, and that is present in Nepal. Parents' name was Suddhodana and Maya Devi. and the place of death Kushinagar. That is present in Uttar Pradesh. Now, like Mahavira, Buddha also a Kshatriya prince, and that kingdom belonged to a ruling Sakya clan. When Siddhartha was 7 years old, his mother died. So he was brought up by a stepmother called Gautami. Four great sights. When he was 29 years old, Siddhartha saw four sorrowful sights. They were an uncared old man with a piece of old cloth, wearing a piece of old cloth with his bent back. And second one, he saw a sick man suffering from an incurable disease. And third sight was a man's dead body was carried to the burial ground accompanied by weeping relatives. And fourth one, he saw an ascetic. Ascetic means a saint. Enlightenment. Buddha means awakened or enlightened one. Buddha means the awakened or enlightened one. Buddha realized that human life was full of sorrows and unhappiness. He left the palace at the age of 29 and he became a hermit. Means he became a religious person and living alone. And he sacrificed 6 years of his life towards penance. Penance means your punishments that one can give to themselves. Then he realized that it was not a way to salvation. It was not a way to salvation. Then he sat under a pipal tree for meditation near Gaya. He went to deep meditation near Gaya. Then on the 49th day, he finally attained enlightenment. On which day he got enlightenment? On the 49th day, he got enlightened. Then from that moment onwards, he was called Buddha or the Enlightened One. And he was also known as Sakya Muni because he belonged to Sakya clan. No, so he was called as Sakya Muni or sage of Sakya clan. Then Buddha delivered his first sermon, first speech at Deer Park in Saranath. That is near Banaras. And that speech was called Dharma Chakra Pravartana. Or we can say the turning of the wheel of luck. Buddha's Four Noble Truths. Life is full of sorrow and sufferings. Then second one, desire is the cause of sufferings. Sorrows and sufferings can be removed by giving up our desire. We can overcome sorrows and sufferings by giving up our desire. Desire is the main cause for sorrows and sufferings. The desire can be overcome. We can overcome the desire by following the eight noble paths. What are they? Eightfold path. Right view, right thought, right speech, right action, right livelihood, right effort, right knowledge, and right meditation. When you follow this eightfold path, you can overcome your desire. So the teachings of Buddha were very simple and they were taught to the people with their language, with their people language. So what they used for their communication. So the teachings addressed the everyday life of the people. So they can relate the teachings with their life. So he was opposed, this Buddha was opposed to rituals and sacrifices. He was against that ceremonies, rituals and sacrifices. Teachings of Buddha. Dhamma is nothing but the teachings of Buddha. Now this Buddhism accepted the theory of karma. Karma means what? Meaning that the quality of man's life, that means the quality of one's life is depending upon their activities. The quality of life is depending upon their activities. Buddha, he neither accepted nor denied the existence of God. He didn't say God is present, but he didn't say God is not there. Neither accepted nor denied the existence of God. But he believed in the law of universe. He believed in the law of universe. Attaining nirvana is the ultimate aim of life. And then fifth point, he supported ahimsa, not to kill any living organism or any living thing. That is called ahimsa or non-violence. And Buddha rejected. He don't like the caste system. Now the wheel of life is the Buddhist view of the world. The wheel of life is the Buddhist view of the world. The wheel of life represents the Buddhist view of world. What is that? Buddhist view of the world. Now we see about Buddhist Sangha. To preach his teachings to the people, Buddha laid foundation for a missionary organization. Organization that is called a Sangha. Sangha means association. Association. The members were called Bhikshus. B-I-K-S-H-U-S. Bhikshus. means months. They lay there the months of this Buddhism were called bhikshus, and they led a simple life. Now we see about Chaitya. Chaitya is nothing but a Buddhist shrine. Shrine is nothing but a temple, Buddhist temple or a meditation hall. Meditation hall. Vigaras are nothing but they are the monasteries, and we can say like this also, living quarters for monks. And then stupas, and the stupas are nothing but they were built over the remains of Buddha's body parts. They are monuments of great artistic value, and they are called monuments, and they have great artistic value. Now we see about the two types of Buddhism, Hinayana and Mahayana. What is the difference between these two sects of Buddhism? Hinayana, in this people did not worship the images, that means they will not keep the statues or any image of the Buddha. But in Mahayana they worship the images of Buddha. Second one, they practice simplicity. But in Mahayana, they followed a long ceremony, elaborate ceremony they followed. And here in Hinayana, believe that the salvation of the individual person as their goal. Only an individual person can attain salvation. But here in Mahayana, they believe that everybody, all living being should get salvation. That is their main objective. And they use Prakrit language. In Mahayana, they used Sanskrit language. This Hinayana is also known as Theravada. And this Mahayana spread to Central Asia, Ceylon, Tibet, Nepal, China and Japan. Japan accepted the middle path. Simplicity of the teachings of Buddha reached the people easily because they teach the people in their local language so that they can easily understand. This Buddhism rejected elaborate customs. But the Vedic religion insisted the people to follow the expensive rituals and sacrifices. People have to follow Dhamma. This Buddhism focus on people should follow Dhamma. And this Buddhist Sangha played an important role in spreading the teachings of Buddha to the people. The kings like Ashoka, Kanishka and Harsha also helped in spreading the Buddhism. Now you see, this Viharas and Buddhist monasteries become the center of education. So So the famous education center was Nalanda. Nalanda is a university where Yuan Xuan, he was a Chinese traveler, studied for many years in Nalanda University. Now we are going to see about the similarities and dissimilarities of Jainism and Buddhism. First we see about the similarities. Both Mahavira and Buddha were from royal families. And they left that and adopted an ascetic life. They are not accepting the importance of Veda. They denied the authority of Veda. They taught in the language of people. And the disciples for both Jainism and Buddhism were from all castes and from both the genders. They accepted both male and female. And then they opposed blood sacrifices. Today we are in some temples, they are cutting cows and goats, no. So they were opposite to that blood sacrifices. They believed in the doctrine of karma. And both Jainism and Buddhism says that instead of performing religious ceremonies and rituals, they give importance to right conduct and right knowledge. Now we see the difference between Jainism and Buddhism. They followed extreme path. Here in Buddhism they followed middle path. Second one, it remained in India only. India only we are having the Jainism, but Buddhism spreads many parts of the world. It spreads many part of the world. It does not believe in the existence of God. They said in Jainism, they said no God. They are not believing in the existence of God, but believes that life is present in everything. Life is present in every living being. They believe that life is present in every living being, but it insisted on anatma. Anatma means no external soul, and anitya. Anitya means nilayamai. We can say in Tamil, nilayamai. These are the difference between Jainism and Buddhism. We said about middle path. That is nothing but neither indulging in extreme attachment to worldly pleasure. We should not have very much attachment to the worldly pleasure, or committing, nor committing severe penance. Now we see the influence of Buddhism in Tamil Nadu. Buddhism spread in Tamil Nadu later than Jainism. Manimegalai is one of the epic that is the Buddhist literature. Buddhist Manimegalai is the epic. We all know that it is an epic. It belongs to the post Sangam age and it is a Buddhist literature. And in that Manimegalai, they explained elaborately about Kanchipuram. Kanchipuram was a famous Buddhist center. Dinaga, the famous Buddhist logician, and Dharmapala, a great scholar of Nalanda University, belonged to Kanchipuram. Ivan Swan visited Kanchipuram in 7th century AD. He noticed that the presence of 100 feet stupa built by the great king Ashoka. Thank you, children.